गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, येस्टरडे वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट आर सब्जेक्ट, इट्स सिलेबस एंड अ बेसिक आउटलाइन. आई ऑल्सो डिस्कस सम टॉपिक्स ऑफ यूनिट वन एंड टुडे आई हैव कम अप विद द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक्स ऑफ यूनिट वन. सो लेट अस स्टार्ट. The topics of today's lecture are structure of ecosystem, in which we will talk about biotic components and abiotic components, and then we'll also discuss about the function of any ecosystem. So to start with the structure of any ecosystem, structure means composition of any ecosystem. Now if we look at any particular ecosystem, if you remember in the last lecture I had given some examples with the help of photographs of some of the natural ecosystems such as forest, desert, ponds, etc. So if you imagine any particular ecosystem, for example, if we imagine about a forest, so what all things you can imagine to be present in the forest? You can find some living organisms in the form of green plants or animals, birds, etc. And apart from that, you will also find the soil, which is a non-living component of any ecosystem. Soil, water, moisture, sunlight, all these things we can expect in any particular ecosystem. So the structure means the entire composition of any particular ecosystem. So I have tried to clear this topic with the help of picture, which is of a pond ecosystem. You can see that picture on the screen. If we look at this picture, which we can call as a pond ecosystem, you will find that there are fishes which are present in this particular pond. Apart from that, few insects can also be expected in this pond ecosystem. And there are green plants. Some of them are floating over the surface of water, some are submerged. So these are the biotic components of this particular pond ecosystem. Apart from this, we can also see water in this pond ecosystem. And if we look at the bottom of this pond, we can find soil in the form of mud. So water, soil, air, all these things can also be seen or found in this pond ecosystem. So all the living components or living things which we see in any ecosystem are called the biotic components of that particular ecosystem. So in this case, fishes, insects and plants will form the biotic component of this pond ecosystem. Then all the non-living things which we see in any particular ecosystem are called abiotic components or non-living components. So here water, soil, air will be the part of abiotic component of this pond ecosystem. So when we study about the abiotic and biotic components together in any particular ecosystem, this reflects the study of structure of that particular ecosystem. So combination of biotic and abiotic components forms the structure of any particular ecosystem. So that was about the structure of ecosystem. Now I would like to show the structure of any particular ecosystem with the help of a flow chart. If we look at the ecosystem, it may have two components which can be categorized as biotic, which are living, as well as abiotic, which are non-living components. Now there are so many living components or living things in any particular ecosystem with different characteristics and behavior. So biotic components can be further subdivided into three major subcategories, and those categories are producers, consumers and decomposers. Producers are those living organisms which can synthesize or produce their food by their own, and in most of the ecosystems, green plants are considered as the producers of any ecosystem, because green plants have chlorophyll in them, and with the help of sunlight, chlorophyll, water and carbon dioxide, they can carry out photosynthesis process, and by this process they can synthesize organic matter in their body. So producers means those living organisms which can make or synthesize their food by their own. Apart from the green plants, there are certain bacteria also present in the nature, which with the help of certain chemical reactions in their body can synthesize their food by their own. The examples are sulfur bacteria, including sulfur oxidizing bacteria and sulfur reducing bacteria, as well as nitrifying bacteria. So green plants and some category of bacteria are kept under the subcategory of producers. Now second category is consumers. These organisms cannot synthesize their food by their own, so they are dependent on producers for meeting out their food demands. The consumers can further be subdivided into three subcategories named as herbivores, carnivores and omnivores. Herbivore, as the name indicates, herb means green plants. Herbivores are those animals which feed on green plants or producers for their food requirement. The examples of herbivores could be rabbits, cow, sheep, goat, etc. Carnivores are flesh eaters. They feed on other animals and they are considered as meat eaters or flesh eaters. The examples of carnivores could be snakes, lion or jackal. There is one more category which is called omnivores, and these organisms can feed on both herbivores as well as can feed on both green plants as well as on the animals. So such category is called termed as omnivores. The examples are humans, chicken, rats, etc. So under the biotic component we have discussed producers and consumers. The third category is decomposers. Decomposers are those organisms which feed on dead and decayed material. It could be dead leaves of a plant or any dead animal. Such organism will degrade the dead and decayed material and extract the nutrients and minerals from that material and use it as a food source. The examples of decomposers could be microorganisms, earthworms, even some protozoans, etc. So producers, consumers and decomposers as a whole will form the biotic component of an ecosystem. Now if we look at the abiotic component or the non-living component, all the abiotic components can be subdivided into two subcategories. The first category is climatic factors or climatic abiotic components, or and another category is adaptive factors or adaptive abiotic components. Climatic factors means all those non-living things which are related to the weather and climate. The examples could be precipitation or rainfall, sunlight, wind, humidity, temperature, etc. And another category is adaptive factors. Adaptive factors means all the non-living components of any ecosystem which are related to soil. The examples could be texture of soil, the minerals which are present in the soil, soil moisture, etc. So that was a flow chart which tells us about the structure of an ecosystem. Now we'll talk about the function of an ecosystem. First of all, we should know that what does the function of ecosystem means. Now if you look at this diagram on the screen, in which you can see that green plants are absorbing sunlight and they are synthesizing food. Now part of that food is eaten by the rabbits, which are called herbivores, and those rabbits are eaten by the carnivores, lion in this case, as well as the omnivores, human beings. Now if you look at this diagram, you can easily see that energy and matter in the form of food is being transferred from producers to herbivores and herbivores to carnivores as well as omnivores. So in any ecosystem, this transfer of energy and matter is very compulsory, because until this transfer will take place, the ecosystem cannot be stabilized. if the transfer of energy and matter keeps on going, the ecosystem will remain stabilized and it will be in a healthier mode. If the transfer of energy gets stopped because of any external reason, then it will bring that particular ecosystem under stress, and if it continues for a longer period, then this ecosystem may have very high chances of being collapsed. So now the energy and matter is transferred to the different animals through the food, and when some of these animals die, then they get converted into decayed and dead material. Then decomposers will start acting over them, and those decomposers will extract energy and nutrients from that decayed material, which will be utilized by them, as well as part of it will be transferred to the soil. Now from the soil, the green plants will again absorb those nutrients and matter, and they will synthesize the organic matter inside them with the help of photosynthesis. So the matter will keep on circulating in any particular ecosystem from one living organism to another living organism, and in this way sometimes it comes to the biotic component, on the other hand it reaches to the abiotic components such as soil, water, etc. So whenever we study about this behavior of any ecosystem, about the transfer of energy and matter, it reflects its functional aspect. So function of ecosystem means to know how energy is being transferred from one particular organism to another particular organism, what fraction of energy is being transferred from producers to herbivores, what fraction of it is going from herbivores to carnivores. So all this complex study reflects the functional aspect of any particular ecosystem. So energy and matter flows in any ecosystem in the form of food and decomposition of dead and decayed material, and this is the function of any ecosystem. Now how can we know about the function of any ecosystem? If I am interested to study about the functional aspect, what should be those methods and procedures which I should utilize to understand about the functional behavior of any particular ecosystem? The function of ecosystem can be understood by knowing about the food chains which are operating in that particular ecosystem. Food chain means the sequence of eating and being eaten in any particular ecosystem. If you look at the living organisms or the biotic component of any ecosystem, you will see that each and every organism is feeding on someone else, and each and every organism is also being eaten up by some other animal. So in this way they form a chain like structure, and that is called as food chain. So in any particular food ecosystem, number of food chains operate in a parallel way. Simultaneously, so many food chains will operate in any particular ecosystem. All animals are free to participate in any food chain which is being operated in that ecosystem. There are no restrictions for any animal. So most of the animals, they participate in more than one food chains. And in this way, they make some connections between two or more than two food chains by participating in both of them. So in this way, it forms a net-like structure which is known as food web. So interconnected food chains, because most of the food chains are interconnected to each other in an ecosystem. So it forms a web-like structure or web-like network, which is called as food web. So by studying about food webs also, we can know about the function of an ecosystem. The third way is to study about the biogeochemical cycles in an ecosystem. Biogeochemical cycles means study of flow of any particular nutrient in an ecosystem. Suppose I am more interested to know how carbon moves in any particular ecosystem. So I will assess the amount of carbon in the producer level, then in at herbivore level, then at carnivore level. Similarly, other nutrients can also be studied. So when specifically we study about flow or the movement of any particular nutrient in ecosystem, it is known as biogeochemical cycle of that nutrient. So by studying about the biogeochemical cycle also, we can understand about the functional aspect of any ecosystem. So these are three ways: by studying food chains, food webs, and biogeochemical cycles, we can study about the function of any ecosystem. Now we will discuss in detail about food chains. As I told in previous slide, food chain can be defined as the sequence of eating and being eaten. Let us take an example of food chain from a forest ecosystem. So in forest, we have green plants, and rabbits feed on the green plants. Jackals feed on these rabbits, and finally lions feed on jackals. So all these four organisms, they form a chain-like structure which can be summarized or which can be called as a food chain. So this is one food chain which operates in any forest ecosystem. So now if we look at this particular food chain, we can see that green plants are at the starting point of the food chain. The rabbits are at number 2, jackals are at number 3, and lions are at number 4. This position of any particular animal in any food chain is known as trophic level. So green plants are at number 1 trophic level, rabbits are at number 2 trophic level, jackals are at number 3 trophic level, and lions, they occupy fourth trophic level in this particular food chain. So any animal which occupies a specific position in any food chain, it is not necessary that if that animal is participating in another food chain also, that animal will occupy the same position. The position trophic level of the animals may vary or change as the food chain changes. So that was about the concept of trophic levels in the food chains. The energy always flows from lower trophic level to higher trophic level in any food chain. If we look at this diagram, we can easily see that energy is transferring from green plants to rabbits, from rabbits to jackal, from jackal to lions. So from lower trophic level to higher trophic level, the energy flow will be always in this manner, from lower to higher trophic levels. Now let us discuss about the types of food chains. In any ecosystem, we may have two different types of food chain, which are called as grazing food chains and detritus food chain. Grazing food chains will start with the green plants. As we saw in the previous slide, a food chain which was started by the green plants. So all such food chains which start with the green plants are called as grazing food chains. The energy from the green plants will be transferred to the herbivores, and from herbivores, this energy will get transferred to the carnivores. So this is the sequence of flow of energy in grazing food chain. The detritus food chains are the food chains which start with the dead and decayed material. It start with dead and decayed organic matter, and the flow of energy in such food chains will be from dead and decayed material. It will get transferred to the detritivores. The detritivores are those living organisms which feed on dead material, detritus material. Detritus means dead. So all those animals which feed on the dead and decayed material, they will get their energy from that decayed material. So energy from the detritus material will get transferred to the detritivores. Some of the detritivores in the environment are fungi, bacteria, protozoans, etc. And from these detritivores, the energy will get transferred to the carnivores, because carnivores will feed on these detritivores. So this is how energy will move in a detritus food chain. In the next slide, we'll see some examples of grazing and detritus food chain. Examples of grazing food chain we'll see first. So we have green plants on which goats will feed. Goats will be eaten by jackal and jackals will be eaten by lion. So this is an example of grazing food chain. Here plants are called producers because they are synthesizing energy. Goats are termed as herbivores because they are feeding on green plants. Jackal and lions will be termed as carnivores because they are feeding on the animal flesh. So this is a perfect example of grazing food chain. Let us see the example of a detritus food chain. It will start with the dead leaves of the plants, and woodlouse will feed on the dead leaves, and crow will feed on woodlouse. So here the food chain is starting with dead and decayed material. That's why it has been called as detritus food chain. So these are some common examples of grazing and detritus food chains which we can see in the environment in an ecosystem. Now we'll talk about food webs. As I told you that food webs are interconnected food chains. We'll see that how food chains gets interconnected with the help of some animals in an ecosystem. I'll try to show it with a diagram. We have green plants and goats will feed on green plants. Jackals will feed on goats and lions will feed on jackals. So this is one food chain which operates in any ecosystem. This is a food chain of a forest ecosystem. So in this particular ecosystem, another food chain can also be seen, that is, rabbits will feed on green plants, wildcat will feed on rabbits, and lions will feed on wildcat. So this is food chain number two which will operate in the similar or same ecosystem. Here we'll see that how these two food chains gets interconnected. Jackals can also feed on rabbits. So jackals are at trophic level 3 and they are making a connection between food chain number 1 and food chain number 2. So these two food chains got interconnected because of the feeding habit of jackals. Let's take some more food chains of this ecosystem. The mouse will feed on green plants and owl will feed on mouse. So this is food chain number 3 of this ecosystem. Now the wildcat can also feed on mouse. So again there is a connection between food chain number 2 and food chain number 3 by the wildcat, because it's feeding on rabbits which are participating in food chain number 2, as well as on mouse who is participating in food chain number 3. Again we got one more interconnection. Let's see one more food chain, that is, grasshoppers will feed on plants, the frogs will feed on grasshoppers, and snakes will feed on frogs. So this is fourth food chain. Here also one more connection we'll see between food chain number 3 and 4. Snakes can also feed on mouse. So again there is one interconnection by the snakes between food chain number 3 and 4, and finally eagle will feed on snakes. So this is how a web-like structure forms in any particular ecosystem because of interconnection of many food chains. Now what is the benefit of such arrangement by nature? What's the significance of these food webs? We'll see. If all the animals have only one feeding option, then what will happen? We'll see. Suppose because of some reasons the population of rabbits decline in this particular ecosystem. It could be a disease outbreak, it could be because of interference of some external dominating animals which starts killing the rabbit population. And if all of a sudden the population of rabbit declines, what will happen? If the wildcat do not have another option of food, then the population of wildcat will also start declining. If the lions have only one option of feeding on the wild cat, then finally the population of lion will also get declined. And in this way, the transfer of energy and matter will stop slowly and slowly in this particular ecosystem, and the entire ecosystem will get collapsed. But because nature has made very excellent arrangement by giving more than one food options to some of the animals, here in this case, because the wild cat can feed on mouse, because of that, till the population of rabbits gets to the normal, the wild cat can feed on mouse and can stay alive. If the wild cat will remain alive, the lion's population will also be alive. So in this way, the transfer of energy and matter will continue even though the population of rabbits decline in any particular phase. So this is the importance of a food web, that it provides a stability to any particular ecosystem if there occurs any disturbance by decline in the population of any particular or specific animal. So we can summarize it as the significance of food chains and food webs are as follows. These food chains and food webs will help in flow of energy and matter in ecosystem. It can also help in control of population of the living organisms, because all animals are feeding on some other animals, so directly or indirectly they are controlling the population of that particular animal. So it makes a balance of the population of all the organism in an ecosystem. The food web gives a greater stability to ecosystem. We just saw how it happens. And food chain also shows a unique property of biological magnification of some chemicals. Now, what is biological magnification? We will try to understand it. Suppose any chemical or pesticide is introduced to any particular ecosystem. It could come to that ecosystem by flowing water from outside area or by any other mean. So that particular pesticide or chemical which is very harmful will be absorbed by the plants and it will remain stored in the plant's body. Now all the herbivores who feed on those green plants, they will also get that pesticide in the form of food, and they will also keep on accumulating that pesticide or chemical inside their bodies. Now all the carnivores who are feeding on these herbivores will also get part of this pesticide or chemical in their body in the form of food. In this way, after some time you will see that particular chemical will spread to the entire community or all the organism, all the animals of that particular ecosystem. Now if you take samples of all the animals who are participating in the food chains and try to get the concentration of that pesticide, you will see that as the trophic level in any food chain increases, the concentration of that chemical will also increase. If you get 1 milligram of pesticide in 1 gram sample of plant, you will find at least 10 milligram sample of pesticide in 1 gram of herbivore's flesh. If you go to higher trophic level, this concentration will even increase. That is called as biological magnification. So biological magnification means increase in the concentration of any particular chemical in any ecosystem from lower trophic level to higher trophic level. So as the trophic level increases, the concentration of that pesticide will also increase. In the next lecture, we'll see that how this biological magnification actually happens in any ecosystem. So that was all about today's lecture. Any query, kindly discuss it whenever there will be a live session. So that was all about today. Thank you.